Hello and welcome to Ullapool. Well, sadly, not Ullapool, but my house. I'm going to guess that, like you and me and everybody else, we've been looking forward to over the last year, focusing throughout this pandemic, this terrible pandemic year, on the second weekend of May, and that pivotal time for all of us, the Ullapool Book Festival. And sadly, both last year and this year, that hasn't happened, and that's why I'm not there. I have to say, as this welcome address from the honorary president of the Ullapool Book Festival, I have to say my honorary presidency has must be the most troubled and troublesome in the entire UBF history. However, I think that even given the fact that we can't be together this year in Ullapool, doesn't mean to say that we're not going to have a fantastic celebration of books and reading and a great Ullapool Book Festival. I mean, in a sense, writers and readers weren't really supposed to be together. I mean, it's all about it. What's so fascinating that we can read people from many, many miles away and many, many centuries apart and still feel the connection. Right now, I'm working on a text in Satire of the Three Estates, written 470 years ago, and yet I feel this connection with David Lindsay. But in Ullapool, we do love being together. We do love walking around the streets of Ullapool and going down to the Cayley Place and of course the Scones and chatting about who we've listened to and what we've heard. And in a sense, I think that can keep on going. And in one sense, better even than usual. This is going to be another great Ullapool Book Festival. Joan and the team have got out their way to make it as Ullapool as possible. And it's as rich and as deep and as varied as it always is. There's Gaelic poetry, there's music, there's poetry from Ayrshire, there's crime from today, the here and now, and from the Victorian era. There's travel writing, there's political writing, there's history. There's all those conversations that we have every year in Ullapool about who we are, where we've been and where we're going. And this year, although we don't have that one special weekend in the second weekend of May, we are going to be together every Wednesday night, right through spring, right through summer into August. So in one sense, that's really, really special. And I'm kind of so looking forward to all that. And this is quite a special spring and summer, hopefully at the end of which the world will look in a more recognisable shape and we can look forward to 2022. Hello and welcome to the Ullapool Book Festival and a lovely session. My name is Chris Dolan. I'm delighted to be here today with you and with our guest, Jim Carruth. A quick introduction, Jim. I'm sure that everybody who's listening in knows exactly who you are and knows your work. But Jim is a Glasgow Poet Laureate or Glasgow Macker. Which is interesting, I think, for a number of reasons. One is that we kind of tend to associate your work more with rural life rather than urban life, though you have written and written very well, I think, on the urban experience as well. And also to have such a lofty post, you're relatively recently come to poetry. You didn't start writing until your 30s. But since that time, Kilbarchan, a verse novella, which does actually look at the whole city experience and addiction, but brings kind of city and country together in really interesting ways, I think. But we're here to talk today about the second of what we hope is going to be a trilogy. I mean, you've, as well as being poet laureate, you've won huge respect and your poetry is extraordinarily wonderful, I think, and hooks you in. I find it endlessly re-readable and finding more each time. But having just come out now, we have Bale Fire, which is the second of your trilogy, the first one called Black Cart. So welcome to Ullapool, Jim. It's great to see you.
Thank you, Chris. What I thought we'd do, we'd read a small set and the chance for discussion and then a second. half, so to speak. As you mentioned, Bale Fire is just out, but I see it very much part of a trilogy. And I thought today, just I haven't read for a couple of years, I thought, well, no, that's a prime opportunity. So I'll read a wee bit of Bale Fire and Black Cart, if that's okay.
That would be fantastic. Interesting to hear them mixed together. So thanks. So carry on.
Because the land are we. Because the land are we. The days a gift of breath. The weeks muscle burden, sweat. The months skin wearing the soil. The years, hands taking the furrows. Our lifetime, a body harvest born. Our death, bones to the earth. Each new voice repeats the ancient song, because the land are we. I'll maybe just start at the beginning of life, birth. Having allowed the young heifer her turn, a fruitless afternoon in the calving pen that did nothing but drain her of energy, I returned to her after the milking of the others, place my hand on her back, talk calmly, loop my bale strings over the soft hooves of front legs barely showing under her tail, and wrap the other end of the frayed twine around my waist, ready to save two lives. When she rests, I will too. When she pushes, I will lean back and add weight to each move. The progress we make working together is measured in the length of legs that inch out. You can't rush, or the mother will suffer more. In the growing pauses she takes to recover, my mind is filled with other births, life's thread, each newborn holding on to find the light. Our children were sliced free from a womb, saved through the help of essential hands. Now the nose and the strong head appears, sticky, the large tongue too, hanging loose, a job still not done, a set of wide shoulders and little room. I tilt them slightly to and fro, till the calf is released to drop by its mother. The speed of this at the end, always a surprise. I untie its legs, stand back a bit and watch. She turns to her own calf, starts to lick her. I find wonder every time in this moment. Just the one parent and child. I, who was born while my father finished milking the cows. I'll just turn to the beginning of my life, watching my parents milk cows. And because I was the eldest, what happened is that they had no one to look after me. So they brought me into the byre and they put two layers of clothing around me and then jammed me into a milk can. I'm told it's frowned upon by social work these days.
It's a lovely image.
Searchlight. A toddler, double wrapped in heavy woolens, wedged snug in the open mouth of a 10-gallon can. I'd watched my parents work down the stalls of Ayrshire's, drawing off milk along the cobbled byre. Over Hunt's shoulders, they'd check on me, high up in my watchtower in that hall of shadows, before bending again to attach the next machine, and the next, till the far end swallowed them in its dark, leaving me for a cluster's regular heartbeat with nothing but cattle bellows, the rattle of chains. I look for them still, listen for their returning voices. I will them back into the light. As I said before, my parents worked together, so side by side during the day, and we always said that my mother brought up four kids in her spare time. Which is, you know, it's true. If she had a spare time to herself in the evenings, she liked to do a small bit of tapestry. And this is a poem trying to talk about that tapestry. Up late, while the last of the sticks crackled on the fire, I'd watch my mother hold the wool end to her mouth, licking a point, pushing it through an eye of silver. Caught in the glow, her face hovered above the wooden frame. With a kingfisher dive, the needle disappeared and surfaced, pulling out rainbows time and again, double back and cut. Her hands, rough and calloused, hacked deep with shadow, thumbnails necked black, crushed by a chain in the bullpen. During the day, these hands held sodden bales, strings sliced deep into skin, carried calves minutes old, slippery as eels, gripped frozen milk pails, graped silage into troughs, dried small tears. Dressed four of us for school, wrenched green shaws from ribbed carrots, chopped potatoes and leeks that simmered for hours for one of those thick, sweet soups we could taste as we stepped off the bus. The hands my daughter watches today, threading colours through a new canvas. I'm going to read a couple of poems about agricultural practice and practical advice now. And this is about meeting a shepherd on a train to Waverley. The big mistake. The big mistake, the shepherd on the train told me, is to clip milking ewes too soon. I put my newspaper down. He'd got my attention. Nothing puts the milk off them quicker than a day like last Wednesday, and when it goes off at this time of year, it never comes back. His warning continued. They never get so rough in the back end and have less protection against the storms and winter chill. He glanced up to his crook in the luggage rack. And another thing is that wool neither weighs so heavy nor looks so well. It's new growth that brings down the scales. A fleece from a ewe that's near hasn't the same feel as one from a ewe that has plenty of rise and a good strong stone. In the beginning of July, the new wool on a thin ewe will grow more in 1 week than under the fleece than it will do in three with the fleece clipped off. He summarised his argument for me. Experienced flockmasters never clip hill stocks before the second week of July. In terms of sheep's sufferings, a strong sun is less severe than a cold rain. He stopped there, looked out of the window at the passing fields, then fell asleep to Waverley, content that a stranger in a suit had listened to his wisdom. This wisdom I now share with you. Couple of other practical poems. An introduction to docking and castration. He tells me his great-grandfather would have used his teeth to pull off the testicles. But that was then. This is now. He takes in one hand a bleating male lamb, 12 days old, while his other wields a sharp blade with slotted grip. He pulls back the youngster's new skin, hacks the tail away, slices the scrotum in a single arc, withdraws the stones all in a minute and a half. This practical art has finality and grace. Ploughing is performance. Violence is in the art. Coulter blade breaks ground, slices through to the dance. The strip of tired sod, lifted up by the share, rolled over by the mouldboard, left on its back in the wake of the plough. Burying that strangled mat, weeds, last season's grass, raising up folds of new colour, breaking the grip of that tight fist, releasing the ridged fingers, soft claps, sigh of soil. In a single furrow laid down, the finished pattern of the field. One of the things about the agricultural community, there's a number of characters. Some of the farmers can be very concise and straightforward in the advice that they give. I was imagining that these farmers giving more practical advice to anyone who would listen on life issues. This is called Bereavement Counselling from Murdoch of Blackbyres. Listen, back in 74, I shot a crow with such force, its body cannoned into its partner, dropped a pear from the sky. The living shared the fall and hard landing of one too close. If that winded bird had not shaken the dust of itself, escaped from the corpse's shackle, raised its torn wings, lifted itself into painful flight, I'd have finished it off as well, coupled them in death. And I think I'll finish with this poem at the end of the first half. I'm very keen to celebrate all aspects of rural life, warts and all. And one of the areas I felt was missing in terms of the canon was poems about silage. And this is a love poem for silage. Oh, sweet, sweet silage. It is now that I will speak of it, a sparkling critique of it, the covered up mystique of it, the flavour so unique of it, the strong and cocky cheek of it, the farmer's hands, they reek of it, it stays with them for weeks of it, their wives, they have to sleep with it, the heifers, they would leap for it, with a missionary zeal for it, the all-day steaming meal of it, the sleek and textured feel of it, the polythene thin seal of it, the language forming spiel of it, the hunger storming beat of it, the winter warming heat of it, the chance to overeat of it, the ritual repeat of it, the scientific feat of it, the engineering skill of it, the building up a hill of it, the thrilling, pleasing ooh of it, the spilling, squeezing spew of it, the bovine teasing brew of it, the taste bud puzzle stew of it, the snappy guzzle chew of it, the happy muzzles moo of it, the love fermenting woo of it, the lovely smelly shoots of it, the swollen belly fruits of it, I fill my welly boots with it, the gorgeous pungent juice of it, my words are so effuse in it, the wonderful excuse of it, the overlasting use of it, all veggies could have fun with it, hell, they could eat a ton of it and still be never done with it, the stunning luscious vein of it, the summer sun and rain of it, the there forever stain of it, the seeping down the drain of it, the milk production gain of it, the Frisians that are fed on it, the gaudy green and red of it, I'll even make my bed in it, enjoy the sweet caress of it and not think any less of it, the sharing out success of it, the feast for any guest of it, the old cows get the best of it, the young beasts eat the rest of it, the fabulous bequest of it, the treasured full-blown breath of it, the rising after death of it, sweet resurrection of grass.
Phenomenal. I suspect you had almost as much fun writing that as we had hearing it.
Yes.
Funny, we were talking earlier actually about some poetry lends itself more to the page, some more to the spoken word, some to both. It strikes me that Evan, you write, does both. Is that something that you're conscious of?
I do want the poetry to be accessible. So when I speak it out, this might be the first time the audience would have heard the poem. So I'm very keen to have an access to the audience so that you hear it for the first time, there's something that makes you want to return. It's also very much about the way I edit the poems. So the edits involve me reading it out to myself, and it means that you're getting much more in the natural rhythm. I'm very keen, and you know, there was a couple of poems in there which are about giving advice. It's very much a conversation. So there's a natural element to that that you're trying to capture. So I also really enjoy reading in public, so it's that opportunity, you don't want to lose it.
Absolutely, and that is quite a special thing, I think, to hear a poet actually read directly to, even if it, you know, these days of being virtual, it still kind of works. You said earlier, Jim, and I found this really interesting about all your work, really, that you want to talk about, in these books, particularly rural life, warts and all was the phrase that you used. I mean, there is real tenderness, there's real beauty, even in the poems you read out there, there's all those things. But it is quite unflinching, isn't it? You do really kind of look at the hardship. Sometimes, you know, what seems almost like cruelty. I mean, that wonderful poem, which I do love the idea of the poem, the bird that escapes, just no more. rather than being united in death. But looking at the sheer kind of your nature, red and tooth and claw, I suppose. So it's that whole mix.
I think so. I mean, it's a very hard way of life. You know, it's not something, you know, it's something I'm aware of and help out with, but it's not something I've got that sort of day-to-day work commitment in terms of a job. But you can see how people suffer, that there's very real, you know, the challenges, for example, and the pressures they're under. You know, they have no control over the weather, which, you know, the frustration, you know, is very much different from what might be seen as an office job. And also, you know, the very real challenge, you know, they look at the rural life and the pressures around with suicide, for example, and there's stuff in around various aspects of abuse. I think there's wider things in terms of the isolation that farmers can feel. It's a very lonely job.
I mean, you actually make a point of talking about both crime and suicide rates in the introduction or your author's note at the beginning of Bale Fire. So yet that you're kind of immediately kind of confronting those hardships, those difficulties.
I think so. And you just have to be very careful when you're talking about the local community or wider. So there's a fictional element of that, but it's not holding away. It's not some sort of rural idyll where it's all soft. It's not, you know, it's chocolate box pictures and stuff. It is very real. But I think that gives you the basis for, you know, what you're talking about, that real connection with real people.
How do farmers respond to it? Have you had...
The response from farmers is usually very positive. They're much more likely to pick up if I made a technical mistake on agricultural practice. You know, well, that's not the way I would dock tails or et cetera, or that's the wrong month of the year. So I had to be really, really careful, especially Killocrees is a good example. Every month I had to make sure that's what would have happened in hill farms. Hill farms are slightly later in the year than their sort of their counterparts on the lowlands and stuff. So I needed to get that right before I started to think about where the poetry would take me. So it's good to have that sort of the checks and balances in there.
And that's a kind of a conversation, isn't it? I mean, the other thing I find interesting as well is the depiction you make of, which I think is very deep and very fulsome, of rural life. And also rural life, which is quite near here. I find that interesting. I'm sure the connection may be before, but Seamus Heaney. But to some extent, although it's actually where my mother grew up, feels that a bit more distant from me. But I find this quite amazing. I'm sitting reading this in the middle of Glasgow, and actually it's just down the road. And that idea about belonging. So you were brought up on a farm, and you spoke earlier about your parents working on a farm or running the farm together. But there's a phrase, I think, somewhere about a promise of belonging. So yeah. You know, where you fit into all this, or where anybody, I suppose, fits into all that.
I think the problem or the concern sometimes is that, you know, this type of life is spoken in the past tense. You know, many of these poems are here and now. And sometimes when we're doing, you know, when I'm reading to audiences, they'll come up after the end of the reading and say, I've got an uncle or a great uncle that's, you know, on the croft, or, you know, I remember a really great holiday that I had. And, you know, when I was young at the summer, and it was a farm we went to and different things. There is that lack of connection that people are now feeling in an urban environment, not specifically with nature, which a number of people are turning to, but that relationship and a working basis with land. I remember you were talking about Seamus Heaney, but he said that the interesting thing is he could only write about the agricultural experience as a past tense, because it was his relationship with his childhood primarily and how that would work. And I think it's just saying, well, no, this is here and now.
And one of the things that's kind of happening through your trilogy, and I was going to ask towards the end, actually, maybe explain now why a trilogy, but also within that, it's very interesting to construct how the books are constructed. So you've got these cycles, but you've also got an ongoing connection with mythology. Which I find really, really interesting. And also your footers. Can you just tell a little bit about how the whole thing fits together?
I see it less as three books, but nine cycles. And I see it as a mapping of a local landscape. And for that, the footers are very much about the language. So they're very much about the local farm names, the local field names, elements of agricultural practice. So that's that wraparound. In relation to the linkages that you talked about, mythology, I think this is the idea about local voices. I mean, I think there's a lot in here, whether you're from a rural landscape or not. You know, it's got this universality, but I do think it's something that's very much about, you know, this is not specifically about the lived experience, about the past experience. When you're looking at communities, there's almost an element of myth, and that, you know, the heroic aspects of that, and, you know, what would be seen as the challenges and the journeys, for example, are involved. And I think it's making that connection, saying, well, no, there's an interconnectedness here with the past, the present, and the myth. You know, a number of the poems are clearly this idea of a fable or a myth, and giving that, you know, it gives you a different perspective that you can bring in to the poems.
I find all that really interesting, how they fit together, because it does actually change. And I found myself doing different things with the poems, sometimes reading the poem and then reading the footer, or reading the footer first, then going back and reading them. It does change once you've got that word in your mind.
Took a bit of convincing with the publishers, because they're saying, oh, no, we don't do footers, or, you know, can you not have a page number and something? But it was always very much part of what I wanted to do. So, you know, I've won these arguments. And I think it does help bind the poems together as well, you know, that language and stuff in it. I think you're right, there's something surprising in there for people, that there's not the end of the poem, there's footers and stuff, and the relationship between footers on opposite pages and different things as well as the poem. So it's very, I'm glad you enjoyed it, because it is something that is very deliberate, and I had to work through to get it to work. I think there's this thing you've said about fit.
I thought it worked really, really well in all the poems. And because that's about the language, again, it brings one word, quite often one word, to the forefront of your mind when you're reading the poem, which is a separate entity. And it got me thinking about language generally, and also maybe the kind of the inheritance of language. It seems to me quite a lot of Bale Fire. Bale Fire strikes you first as being maybe a slightly more unsettled book than Black Heart. Is that right? Is it just the way I read it? I'm not sure. It seemed to me to be, if anything, slightly harsher about the harsh realities of life. But the idea of an inheritance which is being lost, which is something which is fading from our grasp.
I think so. It's much more focusing on what we've seen as the neighbours and local communities and that. And I think you're right. It's a much more challenging book, I think, in that regard. And it is trying to explore the difficult subject matter in a different way. And I think that is that building up of the challenges that the individuals and farms are facing. There's a lot about loss in it as well. And I think that it does have a slightly different feel to it.
I mean, am I right in saying that actually a lot of the farms that you knew as a growing up have actually been lost now?
Almost all of them, completely. The one cycle, there's one cycle where all the footers are local farms that no longer have a dairy herd. And they've either been taken over as a second home, or there's some stables, for example, but the actual agricultural practice has been lost.
Is this irreversible? Do you see this as being something that's in the Scottish context is a loss that can't be regained?
No, I don't think it. I think it can be regained, but they'll have to be careful how letting that land go. And the effort that's been, I always say that when you look at a herd being sold, you're losing that bloodline, so you can't just start next week again. You've got, you know, decades, you know, of the bloodline that's been built up and the work that's been done on the local fields. Let's put it back to nature, for example. There's a hard way to recover that back.
There's a beautiful poem, I think, in Bale Fire, but a Clydesdale horse. And I know that from, I don't know much about rural life, but I know that the bloodlines are fading in Scotland, and that some of these beautiful horses which were created here, yeah, we're kind of, you know, dying out and living in other parts of those. That does strike me as being incredibly tragic, this beautiful, very Scottish type of animal.
I think we just have to be really careful what we're in danger of losing. We need to get the balance right in our use of land. But if you're going to look, you'll lose a local source of produce, and then you're going to import. It's hardly an environmental, you know, and in terms of the environmental challenge, it's hardly a positive move.
Jim, you're going to give us some more poems, and we'll talk more. There's just so much in this to talk about. So yeah, let's hear a few more poems,
okay,
and then we'll chat.
Again, I'll read from both books in terms of going forward. I think just as you've talked about the Clydesdale horse, I'll find the poem that talks about very much about my father's childhood. And this is again a sign of the decline. So in his childhood, all the local neighbouring farms would help each other with harvest, and they would just take turns at helping in the different local farms. But this is about them being dropped off at the end of the day, a horse and cart, and just the day the harvest is over for the day, and just dropping them off as they go through this journey of local farms. There's a small epigraph which is, "Time's wagon ever onward driven," and that's from Pushkin. Black cart. The stook building had finished early that day, so all of us jumped a lift on the miller's big cart, discarding thin shirts in a pile behind the driver. Harvest's favourite sons, bronzed in body, we stood at the back shouting on passers-by, toasting our handiwork with sickly warm beer. Under a big sky, Johnny sang something coarse, and we belled along, proud of our own voices, confident of tomorrow's as if we owned the sun. Some, cursing an old Clydesdale slow rhythm, raced ahead of the cart, impatient for the ceilidh, while others stayed on through a sunset's glow. Beyond here, law, the mare laboured on the bray, strained on its breast strap, the dray shuddered and empty bottles rolled across its wooden floor, boards stained with the dry blood of dead beasts. We, crouched down quick, clung on to the sides, felt then a first shiver and reached for our shirts. Passing those unmarked crossings and road ends, the horse slowed on its journey, but never stopped. So Johnny, his song long silent, must have slipped off, unnoticed. And the others too, when their time came, like orchard's ripe fruit, dropped soft to the ground, disappeared fast down dirt tracks and narrow lanes. Those of us that remained pulled our knees up tight, our thin joints stiffening in the moonlit glint of sickle, our whispers drifting away on a winnowing breeze. Storm clouds rolled in to snuff out every dead star, until there was just me, huddled by the driver's back, the darkest mile left to go, and too late for the dance. When my father was alive, he was a great one for giving me advice on what I should write poems about. And this is one of those pieces of advice. Old Collie. While milking together, my father shouts across the parlour an idea for my next poem. How about a working collie, one that's on its last legs? I tell him that it has been done before. Unwilling to chase this sentimental stick, I leave it well alone, turn away, but feel it lying there, becoming hair and bone. Crouching low, resting its arthritic frame, flecked muzzle flat on its front paws. Lifting itself slowly to its feet, it sniffs out the few short steps to my father, where we both knew it was bound to go. You've probably played this game before, where you talk about who you would have to dinner, and you would pick guests that were either real or fictional, alive or dead, and you would talk through the options. I was thinking on a similar vein, and I thought my gran, who was a great character, what if she'd met Don Giovanni? If my gran had ever met Don Giovanni. If my gran had ever met Don Giovanni, she would have got the measure of the man, shown him her strong faith, stout resolve, gripping her Bible as tight as a lover's hand, not succumbing to his sly and easy charm as he whistled carefree by the byre door, setting himself as a lure in his own trap, belly full of stolen fruits from her garden. Her scowl was death sitting at your table. You'll have had your tea then, my lord. She'd utter just one line. Its full stop would be a barrel closing click at his back. This is a poem in memory of my mother-in-law, Margaret Stewart. Brambles. For you, the word brambles symbolise patience, waiting for green knots to ripen into soft red fruit. It also conjured up verge, hedgerow and scent. September sun on your bent back, dropping berries into baskets, small hands helping, stained fingers and tongues, long afternoon and laughter. This word became a crowded farm kitchen, flour, sugar, salt rubbed together for crumble, over berries, warm stove and juices rising. Then sweet pie cooling in the heart of the table, and you surrounded by family. This word, one winter's day, was the last you ever spoke. After the corncrakes. After they'd gone, our fathers talked with sadness of listening to their rough ratchet at harvest, hidden from view, then later silenced. As we in turn remember our fathers' voices, calling to us as children across the same cut fields, but no longer and nowhere to be found. Homecoming. Never lose this hunger for home. At the end of the day, after long labour in the fields, backache and setting sun, you descend the hill again, soul tired with heavy steps, a weariness that buckles legs from honest hours. Knowing you could have done no more, you watch for a kindling of lights, for smoke rising from the first fires. At your feet, collies swim the dusk. After all this time, you could find your way back blind. There are a number of challenges, as mentioned before, with the rural landscape. And one of those challenges that currently we're very much aware of is the exodus from the landscape of a younger generation. And this is a poem that talks about that exodus, but also the difficulty in that same generation moving back beyond the headlands. Beyond the farm's last headland, the furthest furrow in the parish, everything changes if you let it. Tall blackthorn guards the darkness for those who risk the journey and step into that ancient lane, the other side of the barred gate. The village elders who remember rumour and gossip as teaching call that walk the falling away. The few who return are altered with a strange new coarseness in gait and manner, joyless, slow to share their many demons. Their tales are rambling, incoherent, holding little common ground for those who stayed behind. They cannot remember the days of the festivals, will not sing the old songs, nor help with harvest. At night, though huddled closest to the home hearth, they feel a chill. To look into their empty stares is to find the heart of a double grief, to be lost and found and lost again. As Chris said, there's a couple of the poems look at conflict. And one of the conflicts that can happen is conflicts between neighbours. And this is a poem about two families feuding over a wall. And what this is about is that the two matriarchs of the families taking the wall away, when the rest of the family is at the harvest fair, and it's a poem in Scots, Drystane Dyke. In the end, it took twa women on ilka side of the divide, ain lang afternoon a sair graft, to dismantle that dyke, care awa a' the stains. Their menfolk, lost for years, foo at the hare's fair, were inbred with conflict ahint the land, a dreek inheritance drook it in blood. Ainly passers-by witnessed that day, yon women lilting in a new licht, a walking sang frae common grund. In the beginning, it took twa women. The conflict is not can be not just between neighbours, but within families. And the one of the challenges is obviously what happens to the inheritance. And this is a small poem called Brothers. Two brothers trapped in harness, working their barren years, close enough to share a shadow, they've never known the blessed relief of days apart. A life sentence of love poured out on the beasts alone leaves nothing for kin. A bleak legacy for those unwilling to share this small kingdom. Outliving becomes the only goal, watching the other stoop and fail. Mistrust is the tie that silence binds, tightening like a ring on a lamb's tail, till it severs and falls from life itself. The amount of challenges that farmers face, sometimes words are not enough. Silence. In a small kitchen, they sit for breakfast. Silence seasons their porridge. Though he reads in the paper of falling market prices, he says nothing. Though he leaves his food, pushes the plate away, she says nothing. Though winter feedstocks dwindle and animals sicken, he says nothing. Though too often he burns his soul in cheap whiskey, she says nothing. Though he wakes in the dark, carcass pyres in his eyes, he says nothing. Though last night beyond the winds, she buried his old shotgun, she says nothing. Of all the challenges, one of the hardest things for farmers to do is to give up their farm. Farm sale. Everything is numbered and must go. So he sits at the back of the shed while the crowd pick over the final lots. He lays his cap flat on his knee and slowly stretches a stiff finger to find the faded crosshatch flecks, tracing each tweed field on his bonnet, whispering their old names to himself, walking the boundaries of his lost world. And I think I'll finish with this poem. This is a poem whose premise is that a farmer writes a song and he takes it to the bank to try and secure a loan for seed, legacy. And there's a small epigraph. One of these days you're going to rise up singing. The banker saw no worth in words, so turned down flat that day the offer of a farmer's song as collateral for a loan for seed. At night, the farmer returned home, buried his lyrics across furrows, set never to receive the barley. By the morning, he was gone. Come the spring in that field, beyond his boarded up house, every small word had sprouted with such scent and promise, it brought songbirds flocking, eager to seek each fertile fragment, working the lines day and night, piecing together his forgotten tune. Until the morning they sang as one, that lost farmer's final crop. His harvest was their chorus. They feasted on his song. Thank you.
You have no idea how wonderful it is to hear those read out. I mean, I know these poems, I've read them a lot, and I'm just discovering more in them, hearing them. But they are such wonderfully full, multifaceted poems. They're really terrific. You mentioned there, another quick chat before you give us one last poem. You mentioned there about wars within families, which is as much a city tradition as a rural one, I imagine. But also you mentioned your father there. And I was interested in the choice of mythology you use for Bale Fire, is the Odysseus. I thought that's something I connect with the sea. I suppose it's that thing about homecoming, but it's about Telemachus as well, isn't it? And so I'm just interested in the whole generational thing about your relationship with your father and then that kind of generational aspect of rural life.
I think so. When you think about the Odyssey, it's a journey. And the assumption is, you know, it's a journey that's done by sea, but it's very much a journey of relationships. You know, when I return to the book, it is the relationship between father and son and among other things. And I felt that this was a fertile place to pull it. And, you know, reading the book, the relationships and creating the journey instead of the relationships with the various neighbours, for example. But, you know, the final prediction for Odysseus was obviously that he would not finish his life at the sea, and he would finish it inland. And I think that it just gave us a new in to the you know, some of the topics I wanted to explore anyway.
So now, am I right in saying you're now a city dweller?
I live in the local village, though.
And you still are, right? I thought you actually
lived in the village. I live in the local village, so I've moved a mile away from the family farm, right. Or currently a mile away from the family farm. So my brother is in charge of the family farm, but my son is now currently working full-time there. So that relationship is still there. At the end of the day, you're still saying, what happened today? So you're not, you've just got that connection.
I mean, I love that line and you read it there, never lose that hunger for home. I found myself actually thinking of that line a lot and in different ways. Still on the connections with the generation, but also, you know, where we all end up in our lives. You then mentioned the generations moving away and how hard it is to move back. And I wonder if that's something that connects us to the city. People, you're reading poems and writing poems, which are probably going to be read more by city folk than by country folk. Are you aware of that? And what is your feel about reading from the country to the city, as it were?
Well, I think I'm comfortable with it. I think that when I read to what might be seen as more urban audiences, there's still something about connection there. And they'll talk about, maybe a second cousin or an uncle that either is still in the croft or a family holiday that they might have had in the summer where they were on a farm, gathering eggs in from the hens or helping with the harvest. And I think that is something that they feel is a loss in terms of connection. The other thing, I think a lot of the poems are about community, about relationships with family, and that's the same for us all. You know, it's just there's a lot of connections in there, irrespective of where the poems are set. These are stories about love, loss, challenge, and those are things that we all face.
I think you're right, actually. I think that is notable, that though we are reading about a very specific kind of lifestyle, actually, what you feel is, well, I feel that too. I might feel in a slightly different way, and I don't know about how you castrate any animal, but there is that kind of connection there throughout. I mean, I found that idea that people feel they've lost something. I write a lot and know Spain a lot, and I've always found, I've never met a Spaniard yet who actually is from Madrid or is from Barcelona. Even if they've been there for generations, they are from some village. And they'll actually say that, you know, we are from Monreal, some small village somewhere. But I think it's actually to some extent true. It's maybe not as spoken as much, but I feel it's kind of true of Scotland too. Most people have a connection, even if they've been city folk for years.
I'm almost taken by the connection people have to the islands is a good example. So, you know, I'm originally from, you know, I'm originally from Lewis and Eust. That you don't have to be into a conversation very long before that line, you know, those lines come up. And I think you're true. I think you're right. It's just, there is something that ties us. It's not a connection we want to sever easily.
So that, I mean, I you know more about the genres, but geopoetics and ecopoetics, they still talk to city population for those reasons, don't they? And also, I mean, we also do have a relationship with our own environment in the cities. But yeah, that kind of idea of how connected we are to the landscape in which we know.
Yeah, and it's a connection with the landscape, and you get that a lot within the nature writing. But sometimes it's I'm visiting the landscape to return, and this connection where you're wanting what might be seen as a larger commitment to the land, and you know that is a completely different relationship.
Brilliant. So I mean, it's all wonderfully in there. I've got one last question before we go on, and hopefully going to give us another poem. You read one of your Scots poems. I think there's only three, maybe four, in both books altogether. Why, first of all, do you choose to write less in Scots? And I kind of, I don't know why I expected more, but actually I didn't realise I wasn't reading Scots until I read a Scots poem. There's something about, it feels as if the poems which are written in English are actually infused with Scots anyway. Maybe that's got to do with agricultural language you use quite a lot or whatever, but yeah, English, Scots.
Yes, most of the poems are written in the language that I would speak. So the element of Scots coming in is fine. Normally the Scots poems, they're in for a purpose. They've either not worked in English or I feel that there's more that can come out of them. So the Dry Stained Dykes poem earlier, you know, I looked at it as an English version. It didn't come off the page. It wasn't giving what I wanted it to do. In other Scots poems, there's always something as a perspective that's bringing me in something that's fresh rather than, you know, something that might have, you know, looked in English at. So there's always usually, you know, the ones that work have a clear purpose in mind.
So it's an interesting example you use there. And I always think a dry stone wall sounds very uninteresting, whereas a dry stained dike just sounds, sounds wonderful. I want to see them.
As soon as you start, you know, and it was, you know, it was as obvious as the title, you were somewhere else, you know.
Well, before you do another poem, it's a trilogy. Are you writing the next bit, and what and how does it relate to Black Cart and Bale Fire?
The third book, in my mind, is finished. There were some pieces that I felt were unresolved in the previous books. You know, I wanted to focus, for example, a lot in, you know, a bit more in my relationship with my father, who died through the cycle, and also wanted to look at the idea of people working in the community and trying to relate to the community. So there's a number of poems that hopefully in the new collection which look at the work of the Glasgow Boys, and they look at their attempts to work with the community and work within the communities and reflect in their paintings, for example, the way of, you know, the ways of working that they could see. And there's been music, there's that reflection on that side of it. And I felt that something, in terms of one perspective anyway, a more visual look and how people relate to, you know, a community that they've not been brought up in would be another perspective I'd like to explore.
Ah, oh, sounds great. Sounds absolutely great. Give us one last poem and we'll have a very brief chat at the end of that.
Before I give you one final poem, I'd just like to thank Joan and our army of volunteers who, on a typical year, do sterling work. And the one thing about being virtual this year is I'm definitely missing the home baking and look forward to being at the festival in person next year. One of the challenges with the rural environment is not just the what would be seen as the working landscape, but also the social element. And what has been noticeable over the decades is that many of these social events that used to be highlights of the year are much quieter. And it's definitely true of the barn dances. One of the areas that's particularly challenging is that your choice of dance partner is more limited. It's particularly acute when it's a dance that we're talking about, such as the progressive Canadian barn dance, and you have this limited range of individuals, possibly old farmers that are coming round, and you can see them coming round time and time again. This is a poem seen from the perspective of a young girl whose mother has taken her to one of these dances, and it's how she experiences the dance herself. So, the progressive Canadian barn dance. The first time she wore the new dress was at the farmer's harvest dance, on a night breathless and warm. Uneasy with her body's new bloom, she would have sat the night out, had her mother not dragged her up, to be thrown around like a doll, from rough hands to rough hands, from Anderson to McGregor, from McGregor to young Wilson in his father's tight tweed jacket, from Wilson to Clubfoot Brogan, from Clubfoot Brogan to Lamberton in his scabby working bonnet, from Lamberton to the Moleman, from the Moleman to his apprentice, staring at her in his strange way, from the apprentice to Patterson, who danced fast but talked slow, from Patterson to Uncle Jack, not her real uncle, of course, who held her too close and grinned, talked about how much she'd grown up. She struggled free from his grip, found one of the Mackenzie boys, from one of them to the other with their shiny new market boots, and on to old Wilson with his crook, and on to his buddy Baxter, smelling of his blackface flock, from his strong stench to Anderson scratching his ringworm, from Anderson to McGregor, who burled her until she was dizzy, from McGregor to young Wilson, they say he'll never be his father, from Wilson to Brogan's brown eyes, from brown-eyed Brogan to Lamberton, who threw his bonnet onto a seat. She grabbed him, the pace quickened, the dance lifting her dress up light as air. She spun him away before moving on from Lamberton to the Moleman, sweating locks through his winter shirt. After the Moleman, his apprentice, from the cross-eyed apprentice to Big Patterson, flustered and red. From Patterson, not onto Uncle Jack, who was wheezing at the bar, but the clumsy Mackenzie boys taking turns to bruise her feet, before passing her to old Wilson, who staggered to keep up with her, mentioned he once courted her mother. Oh, surely not, she laughed out loud, winked at him with a new confidence, glanced back at her mother, then on to his drinking pal Baxter, from his beery breath to Anderson, from Anderson to McGregor, from McGregor to young Wilson, from Wilson to Johnny Brogan, who clasped her hand tight and echoed her smile, and the music stopped.
That was fantastic. Thank you so much, Jim. The whole session's been an absolute joy. It's a shame we're not in Liverpool. And I should have thought of certain things, like actually trying to do some home baking, though I could never live up to the home baking of Liverpool, so I'm glad I didn't even try. And that poem, we missed the Cayley as well. But I know that that's going to be hugely appreciated by the UBF audience who'll be watching tonight. These poems are really, really beautiful. There's just so much in each of them. I found myself reading them and rereading them and going back over them and discovering new things. And now hearing Jim read them, they seem to me even other elements I hadn't come across. So Les Lockhead says of Bale Fire, it's a crop of the most rooted, most unflinchingly intimate poems. Bernard O'Donoghue calls Bale Fire, I think, a book of lucid and visionary power. They both are all these things anyway. So both Blackheart and Bale Fire, and hopefully the new one. I wish you huge amount of success with their wonderful poems. And one final thank you so much, Jim Carruth from Liverpool Book Festival. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris.
On the edge of the west, beneath the wilds of the Fannies, the Jeeri, Bengolach, Ullapool, Cooridin sanctuary.
Where the skies rise further, where the heather scores the west, Summer Isles, Hebrides.
These houses painted white, a metropolis whose streets you can count on your fingers, and the pier, its tongue stuck out, licking salt from the air.
Here are friendly, welcoming people. Fish suppers, a ferry black and white, flapping flag, silver sparkle, coconut broom.
Here, it's the scale of what blows through you as the wind burls the islands, sieving winter's thoughts from our heads.
And all along Market Street, the bloom of cherry blossom, making a Japan of Ullapool.